God is good.
All the time.
All the time. In Matthew chapter 6, would you read it with me, please? Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. In other words, labor unto the Lord. Amen. For where your treasure is, there your what? Your heart will be. The lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? In other words, you may start off right, but you can drift, depending on what you allow your ears to receive and what your eyes are open to. What you put before you. Those are gates. You got eye gates, ear gates. And in these gates, what you allow in will come. And I can tell you, spirits follow. Thank you. Spirits follow. Demons follow. Your fight and my fight is against the powers of darkness and wickedness in heavenly places. Addiction is not a disease, it's a demon. And once that demon is removed, we're free. Fear is not a disease, it's a spirit. Asthma is not a disease, it's a spirit. It's called a spirit of fear. When that spirit is removed, people get healed. When spirits removed from people, they get healed. That's why the more that you eat of the light of God, the more darkness gets removed. But he says here, look at, if you begin to put your eyes on things and you begin to hear certain things, and according to the ways of the world, your light that used to shine is going to go dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. And you'll be just like the heathen. Hello? Praise God. Verse 24. It says this. No one can serve what? Two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon or money or the ways of the world. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't worry about your life. If you're in position, you got nothing to worry about. But if you're not, you got to be shaking in your shoes. Amen? Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you'll put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Let me share something with you, that when people become fearful and begin to worry, it's an open door for the enemy to actually come and steal. Because they're not trusting God. When you sense that fear coming, you need to change your words. Because what you speak is what you eat is what you become. You're either going to bring the presence of God to help you, or you're going to bring the presence of evil to destroy you by what you speak and by what you do. So when you sense that circumstance, especially when you have bills come in, you're like, I trust you, Lord. I thank you that you do far above all I could ever ask or think. I cast this care upon you, for you care for me. You bought me by the blood of Christ. I'm yours. I have a lifetime warranty. Amen? I'm labeled. Do not dry clean. Praise God. Warning. Hallelujah. Verse 27. Which of you by worrying can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet I say to you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles, the heathens, for they, your heavenly Father, for even the heathens think that way, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things, but do something. Do what? Seek first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness. And all things will be what? Added to you. That is so profound. Seek the kingdom of God. Seek his face. Go after him. What is this righteousness? It is his character. What are you asking for? You want to act the way he would want you to act. Amen? See, there are three kingdoms and there's two realms. There is the kingdom of self, which you and I live in. This is called the matrix. It's like a maze. Then there's the kingdom of Christ, which is unseen. Then there's the kingdom of Satan. Both of these kingdoms influence this kingdom here, kingdom of self. Does everybody understand? So if you don't know what's influencing you, then you're easily deceived. Because Satan's greatest weapon is deception. The world is ruled by deception. And many people fall into it. They dance with it. They dance with the devil and don't even realize it. They accept whatever man says according to the world, but never even open a Bible to find out what the truth is. I used to be one of them until the Lord came and visited me, delivered me, healed me, and said, this is true. This is the manual. Amen? This is the manual for training. So in these three kingdoms, we have Satan's kingdom that utilizes influence by fallen angels, demons, and people who just choose to serve Satan's kingdom. Amen? And then we have Christ's kingdom. And in this, everything is guided by angels and the Holy Spirit. So you have fallen angels and demons, or holy angels and the Holy Spirit that are leading and influencing us. And individuals that are born again of the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, and staying clean from the world. See, in Satan's kingdom, things that he produces is sin. Sin is the presence of evil. Amen? So he promotes rebellion, doesn't he? He wants us to agree, actually, and most people don't even know that there's a Luciferian agenda. He wants us to agree with the ways of the world and what the world says. So then we follow the agenda of Satan's kingdom. Or the righteous agenda is the presence of God. Righteousness is acting according to the divine moral and nature of God Almighty. That's what righteousness is. It is the act. It's how you and I act according to the divine nature and moral and moralities of God. In other words, what pleases him? What's pleasing him? And everything that you and I do and things that we're making decisions as, Lord, is this pleasing you? See, but if you're not connected to him, then you won't even ask. If you're not connected, you're not even concerned. You're just going to do whatever you think or whatever you feel. Never realizing that there's a consequence to everything we do. Because there's a ripple effect and there's a reaping of every decision and everything we do. What a man sows, he what? Reaps. Amen. And he who sows to flesh, which is evil, he who sows to the presence of evil, who promotes evil, will reap corruption. Amen. So there's an area where there's a difference because God requires that we not only know righteousness, but practice righteousness. And you cannot practice righteousness without the presence of God. It's impossible. Amen. 1 John chapter 3. So the only way to have dominion over the powers of darkness is to be submissive under Christ. Amen? 1 John chapter 3. Something powerful. It says, submit to God, then you're able to resist the devil. But if you're not submitting to God, If you're not practicing righteousness, because if you're not submitting to God, you can't practice righteousness. So if you're not practicing righteousness, you're not submitting to God. If you're not submitting to God, then you're submitting to the devil, one or the other. There is no in between. Well, it's just what I feel like. Well, then what you're feeling like is influenced from somewhere. Amen. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. Would you read it with me? Whoever commits sin also commits what? Lawlessness. And sin is lawlessness. And you know that he was manifested, Jesus was manifested to take away our sins. And in him there's what? No sin. Verse 6, read it with me. Whoever abides in him does not sin. Whoever abides in him doesn't practice sin. Doesn't mean you don't make a mistake, but you step out right away. In other words, abiding means connected. If you're maintaining your connection with him, you're not doing the things that displease him. Amen? If you're maintaining the connection with him, you're manifesting the fruits of the Spirit. You will not only have peace, joy, and righteousness in the Holy Spirit, which is God's love, but you will love him even more. You will desire to be in his presence. You will desire. You're not doing something just to protect your blessed assurance from going to hell. You're doing it because you love him. Amen. If there's not a love there, then there's a disconnect. Amen? In verse 6, whoever abides in him does not what? Sin. And whoever sins has neither seen him or known him. Little children, let no one what? Deceive you. He who practices righteousness is what? Righteous. Just as he is righteous. And he who sins is of the what? Devil. So can somebody walk righteous and in turn and become unrighteous? Yes. Why? God does not interfere with your choice. See, this is where people are not consistent in seeking God's face. That means seeking his presence. They get disconnected very easily because of the ways of the world. They open their doors because of things they see, things they hear, and things they associate with. Remember, associations bring impartations. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. And whoever has been born of God doesn't do those things. If you're maintaining your born-again experience, you don't do those things. Other than that, you are lost because you're living outside of salvation's truth. Amen? For his seed remains in him, and he cannot what? He doesn't sin. He doesn't want to sin because he's been born of God. In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God. That's how you check yourself. Am I practicing righteousness? If I'm not, then I'm out of order. I'm lost, living outside of salvation's truth. If I'm not practicing righteousness, there's something wrong. The influence that is I'm listening to, the things that I'm putting in my eyes, the things I'm putting in my ears, the things I'm receiving and believing, if they're not producing righteousness, then they're producing lawlessness. Because there's either righteousness or lawlessness. For whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God. In other words, people get disconnected. Nor is he who does not love his brother. Is everybody okay? For this message that you heard from the beginning, that we should love one another, not as Cain, who was of the wicked one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his works were of what? Were evil, and his brothers were what? Righteousness. So there's one or the other, isn't there? Amen? There's what? One or the other. Righteousness, again, is act according to the divine nature of God. In other words, we should be exposing the presence of evil, not promoting it. Amen? We should be what? Exposing it, not promoting it. The word says, depart from evil. It's amazing how many people still pet evil. They justify evil. They even vote for evil. They don't know that there's blood on their hands and everyone's accountable. Matthew 7. One of the things that people do not look at, the word says you'll know them by their fruit, right? In other words, people are looking at people. Right now, we've got all kinds of political things going on, don't we? Amen? People need to stop looking at the people and look at the agenda. If you look at the agenda, you'll know where their intent is. It's real simple. There are those that want to try to destroy this country or trying to build this country, one or the other. And believe me, if you want open borders, then you're going to destroy this country. It's real simple. Even God himself set borders and boundaries. And so should this country. Hallelujah. Is everybody okay? Matthew chapter 7 and verse 13. Oh, yeah. Are you ready? Amen. Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to what? Destruction. And there are many who go in by it. There are many who go in. You know, people are going to, there's going to be a rude awakening, especially when people get before the Lord and he says, I don't know you. Well, you know, I know you. Well, I don't know you. You may have heard about me. You may have even read about me, but you didn't follow me. Only those that follow him, he knows. Not those who say they know him. Not even those who say they love him. Only those who follow. Has everybody got it? Those are the ones that are producing righteousness. If you're not a follower and say that you know him, then you're a liar. And that's the eyes of God, and that's how he sees it. Verse 14. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to what? Life. And there are few who what? I mean, come on. If that's not a reality, there are few who find it. Whew. You know, there was a testimony about a gentleman that died and went to heaven. And he was amazed because everyone went in before the Lord one at a time. And he was amazed when he realized that 90-something percent of the people didn't make it. Can you imagine that? What he saw. Over 90% of people did not make it into heaven. That's what he was seeing. Because people thought they were good. People thought they were doing the right thing, but nobody ever searched out to find out what the heck's going on. They thought they were doing good works by just giving money or doing this or that. No, he said, follow me. And only if you follow him can you enter in. If you're not a follower, there's no way you can enter. It's impossible. That's why it's narrow and only few find. Jesus paid a price for all to find, but many are not willing. They're still doing their own things. Not really, truly willing to follow. In verse 15, what does it say? Beware of what? False prophets or false Christians who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their what? Fruits or their agendas. Their intents. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears what? Bad fruit. Hello. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is what? Cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will what? Know them. Now, is Jesus speaking to unbelievers or believers? Believers. So-called people that say, I believe. Then what does he tell them? Watch, this is confirmation. He says something powerful. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the what? Will of my Father in heaven. That means you got to follow. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, I have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons in your name? And done many works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Why? Because you didn't follow me. Depart from me, you who practice what? lawlessness. Why? Because if you're not practicing righteousness, what are you practicing? Lawlessness. And then, and is everybody okay? Verse 24. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and what? Does them. That means you follow. I will liken him a wise man who built his house on the rock, on the anointing of Christ Jesus. And the rain what? Descended. The floods came. And the winds blew and beat on that house. And it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock, Christ Jesus. You know what? I don't know if you know or not, but the West is burning. We've had record temperatures. The change of the atmosphere and weather has changed tremendously. Why? Because it's prophetic. It's fulfillment of end time prophecy. There are the highest temperatures, 112 degrees and all kinds of stuff in this country. There are record-breaking temperature changes. The West is burning. The East is flooding. It's happening. And people don't even understand. They're too busy with their own life. Verse 26. But whoever hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its what? Great was its fall. Listen, the word says the wages of sin is death. If you're not submitting to God, you're submitting to the powers of darkness, demons and devils. Then you're producing lawlessness instead of righteousness. Righteousness is acting according to the divine nature and moral realities of God Almighty. Amen? Other than that, people are practicing the things according to the secular world. Paganism. Heathens. That's what he calls them. In Matthew 18. Matthew 18. Do you want to know the truth? This is truth. Hallelujah. In verse 15. Is everybody there? It says, moreover, your brother sins against you. Go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. If you've been approached by individuals saying, you know what? You're out of order. Amen? You know what, man? You need to get in order. You know, you need to get in order. You're out of order. If you've been approached by people and shared with you, you're out of order. Then there's something you need to take heed to. In verse 17, if he refuses to hear them, then tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a what? A heathen. And a tax collector. Talk about the IRS, right? Bunch of heathens. In fact, what they're doing is illegal anyways. But who rules the earth? Satan. And he rules it by what? Deception. Does everybody understand? Anyone who refuses to hear what God is saying, anyone who refuses, God considers him out of order, lost, L-O-S-T, living outside of salvation's truth, and considers them a heathen. Why? Because they're not submitting to the Lord, then they're submitting to paganism. They're submitting to something different. Is everybody okay? Go to 2 Chronicles. No. We'll go somewhere else first. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2. First John chapter 2. I want to confirm something that we've already spoke on. Verse 15. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15. It says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the Father, the love of the Father is not in him. Hello? For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away, and the lust of it. But he who what? Come on, say it with me. But he who does the will of God abides forever. He who does the will of God. Now, can you do the will of God if you're not following? Are you doing the will of God if you're not producing righteousness? Then you're lost. Amen? Does everybody get it? Amen. Abide in God, does his will. That's where fruits of righteousness are. That's where he says, depart from evil. Don't approve evil. And then an entrance will be granted to you to heaven. But other than that, no entrance will be granted. Doors are shut. That's why Jesus said, I am the way. I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life that is called the eternal port. And only those that are producing the fruits of righteousness will go through that port. Anyone else will not. But I'm a good person. That's got nothing to do with righteousness. Does everybody get it? 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Like I said, there's going to be a tremendous rude awakening when people stand before the Lord. That's why they need to get before him every day. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 12. Oh, it's good to hear the pages turning in the house of God on a Sunday morning. Remember, this is training, isn't it? In verse 12, let's speak it together. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name will what? Humble themselves. It's called repent. And pray. Hello? And pray and what? And seek my face. If they will humble themselves, if they will pray, if they will seek my face. He's asking individuals to do this because only through prayer and seeking the face of Christ can reality come. It's called the face of reality. In fact, that's the name of today's teaching. Everyone say face of reality. It's time people faced reality. Amen. If my people will call by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their what? Wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and what? Heal their land and even heal their body. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to prayer made in this place. For now I have chosen and sacrificed this house, or sanctified this house, that my name may be there forever. Are you the temple of God? Yes. Then this temple should be sanctified. So when we defile it, the fruits of lawlessness are produced, not the fruits of righteousness. For now I have chosen and sanctified this house that my name may be there forever, and my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. As for you, everyone say, as for me. If you walk before me as your father did, as your father David walked, and do according to all that I have commanded you, and if you keep my statutes and my judgments, then I will establish the throne of your kingdom as I coveted with David, your father, saying, you shall not fail to have a man as ruler in Israel. But if you turn away and forsake my statutes and my commandments which I have set before you, and go and serve what? Other gods. The moment you go to serve other gods, lawlessness is produced and fruits are ceased of righteousness. And worship them. Then I will uproot them from my land which I have given them. In this house which I have sanctified for my namesake, I will cast out of my sight, and I'll make it a proverb and a byword among the peoples. Does everybody understand? He's talking about us now. That's Old Covenant, Old Testament. But he's talking about us as the temple. He said, seek my face. Put him in front of you. To what? Expose sin. Amen? To do what? Expose sin. Seek my face. Put him in front of you to expose sin. He said, pray by making connection. Amen? We're always maintaining connection with the Lord. You know, it's amazing in how many false, he said, don't serve other gods. How many false religions there are, all kinds of crazy stuff that's going on. You know, if people ever searched out other belief systems, there's only one who rose from the dead. Amen. You can't cast out a devil in any other name but the name of Jesus. Amen. You got people worshiping statues, praying to the dead, walking around a square block. Come on, think about it. The Muslims in Mecca, they walk around a square block because there's a granite in there. Come on, think about this. You got all kinds of belief systems and all kinds of crazy things going on. You got other religions and Hinduism and all kinds of stuff that are, they'd rather starve to death than kill an animal and eat and live because it might be Uncle Jane or Grandma or somebody. Does anybody get this? Come on, these are crazy belief systems. And this is only produced by evil, by deception. And if you don't believe certain things, I mean, come on, they're going to cut your head off. I mean, there's so many crazy doctrines. Jesus warned us, he said, there'll be doctrines of demons and seducing spirits, which are happening right now. People are dying. Jesus came to bring life and life abundantly. He came to bring freedom. And only where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. But there's something we must be willing to do. Cooperate. That's where freedom is. You know, when I was in the world, I tried all kinds of things. I tried drugs. I tried everything. I tried gurus. Tried witchcraft. Tried it all. I never got free. But I'll tell you, if you're truly seeking truth, you'll find Jesus. Amen. Only Jesus. He is the truth. He is the way. He is the life. He's the only way. But I'm telling you, the powers of darkness, you got to remember this world is ruled by Satan's kingdom. Amen. And in this realm, this is called the Matrix. It's a maze. People are walking and doors are opening and shutting. They don't even know why. And they're just going through them. But the only way out of this place is Christ. That's the only way out. That's the only way out of deception. That's the only way out. People are blinded and taken captive. And you know what happens? They put on prison garments. And they're actually prisoners. Does everybody understand that? They become pawns in Satan's kingdom. And they don't even know it. They're just living their life trying to do the best they can. But because of certain traditions that have been handed down the line, certain belief systems have been handed down the line, certain cultures that have been handed down the line that are lies, and it doesn't, you know, my first reality after my visitation from the Lord was everybody lied to me, even my parents, even the church I used to go to. They lied. And they didn't do it on purpose. They just didn't know the truth. I would never read this. Unless the Lord came and said to me, guide, this Bible is true, I would have never gone to it. Why? Because I was told by a priest when I was a kid that the Bible ain't nothing but a story. I don't want stories. Well, they smoked their cigarettes and drank till they fell off their chair. And then they pray to the dead. My sister Mary, they pray to. How ridiculous. And then they call saints and they pray to saints. It's called necromancy, and it brings a curse on a person's life. And they wonder why they can't get where they're supposed to go. This is called deception. Does everybody understand that? I'm not speaking against anyone or anything. I am exposing deception. Why? Because truth is what sets you free. Amen. Only truth. I am walking here today. I am free because of truth. Right. Nothing else. I don't need to pray through somebody. I can pray directly to my daddy because I'm his son. And he's my dad. I don't need anyone to intercede for me in that arena. I already have the greatest intercession. His name is called Jesus. He intercedes for me. I got the Holy Spirit praying for me. I got Jesus for me, praying for me. And I got my spirit praying through me, through the Holy Spirit. Man, three, you can't. I'm kicking butt. Hallelujah. Does everybody get this? Freedom is the greatest thing. Freedom from torment. Freedom from emotional torment. Freedom from sin. Freedom from deception. Freedom. Glory, I love it. Oh, I won't go to them. I could talk about all the goofy religions out there. It'll blow you away. You don't go to church on Saturday, you're going to hell. I mean, come on, all these rules and regulations. How about a relationship with the one that created you? That's it. Amen. How about calling the name that's above all names, who brings healing and deliverance and freedom? That's all. 2 Corinthians 4. You know, even Solomon, now check this out. Here's Solomon. God gave him the wisdom to lead his people and everything. And God warned him. What did Solomon end up doing? He ended marrying a pagan girl. And multiple. He had pagan wives. And he began to build altars to pagan gods. And he lost everything. Everything. And Israel went in captivity. Why? Because God said, do not be unevenly yoked with unbelievers. An unbeliever is one that's not walking right. Oh, but they call themselves a Christian. No. One who follows is a Christian. One who doesn't is not. 2 Corinthians 4, face of reality. It's time to face reality. In verse 1, would you read it with me, please? Therefore, since we have this ministry, we have received mercy, we do not lose heart, but we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness or handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. But even if our message of truth, the gospel, is veiled, it is veiled to those who are what? Perishing. They're dying. Whose minds the God of this age has blinded. And who's the God of this age? Satan. Who do not believe. That word believe means to follow. Oh, I believe, but I'm just going to follow whatever I feel like doing. That ain't believing. Who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine upon them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves bondservants for Christ's sake. For it is God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. But we have this what? Treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of who? Not of us. For we are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down and not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body of the dying Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in us and through us. Does everybody get it? Oh, glory. I want to go back to verse 6 for 1 second. It says something powerful. It said it's God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus. In the what? Face of Jesus. The face of Jesus. It's the reality. See, when you're actually seeking him and see his face, when you seek the face, you seek him. It's the face of reality. All reality. What is real? What isn't? What is clean? What is unclean? What's holy? What's unholy? What's pleasing? What's displeasing? What's righteous and what's lawlessness? The only face that brings through the mask of mankind. Mankind has a mask. Everybody has a mask. Is everybody with me? Hold tight. Everybody has a mask. Only as you walk through the Lord, walk with the Lord more and more and more, as you press in more and more and more, your mask melts away. Does everybody get it? Other than that, people have a mask. That's what Jesus called people hypocrites. It means pretenders. See, people put on the mask and they go out and tell everybody, you can make it up. You can beautify it and all kinds of other stuff. But there is a mask there that must melt away to the true reality of who you are. And until that mask is burned through by the face of Christ, true identity comes. Other than that, people are still trying to find out who they are. That's why they carry this mask. They still don't even know. Let's see, who am I? Today I'll be a hairdresser. Tomorrow I'll be a basketball player. Does everybody understand? They make their identities by the things of the world. And that's what they call themselves. They call themselves by what they work. They call themselves by their talents. They call themselves by their organizations. Hi, I'm a Catholic. I'm a Protestant. I'm a this. I'm a that. But you know who you are in Christ. Is everybody with me? In Christ. And only by seeking the face of Christ are you able to know. Because only his face will burn through yours. Amen. I'm going to say it again. Only his face will burn through yours, your mask. Amen? Is everybody okay? It's not cover boy or cover girl. Hello? It's face to face. That's why Moses got to speak to the Lord face to face. And you and I should be speaking face to face. And the more that you seek, the more that you pray, the more that you're connected, your mask begins to melt away. Everyone is born with a mask. Amen? It must melt away. Is everybody okay? Hallelujah. Matthew 22. Oh, God is good. Everyone say, face of reality. Matthew 22 and verse 2. The kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who arranged a marriage for his son and sent out his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding, and they were not willing to come. Again, he sent out other servants saying, tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen, fatted cattle are killed and all things are ready. Come to the wedding. But they made light of it and went their ways. One to his own farm, another to his business. And the rest seized their servants, treated them spitefully and killed them. But when the king heard about it, he was furious. And he sent out his armies, destroyed those murderers, and burned up their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. Therefore, go into the highways, and as many as you find, invite to the wedding. So those servants went out into the highways and gathered together all whom they found, both bad and good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on wedding garments or righteous garments. In fact, he had on prison garments. So he said to him, "Friend, how did you come into here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to the servants, "Bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen." For the gate is narrow, isn't it? Many are called, but few are chosen. One of the things that begins to happen is, you know, when you and I are born again in the Spirit, we get priestly garments. Those are called the garments of righteousness. Of course, if you're not producing righteousness, then you're something ain't right. And what happens is the enemy comes to try and exchange garments. And he exchanges the garments with false belief systems, with sin, with worship of other gods. Does everybody understand? And people give up their priestly garment in exchange for what we call prison garments. Why? Because they've been taken prisoner to Satan. They've been taken captive. And they begin to produce lawlessness and no longer producing righteousness. Remember, righteousness is the act according to the divine nature of God Almighty. That's righteousness. It's not being good. It's producing righteousness. Amen? Because even people that say they're good usually do evil. They approve of something evil. Amen? There are believers that are still reading their horoscopes. They're still going to psychics. All kinds of things, trying to get information from the powers of darkness to find their future. And it brings a curse on them and they don't even realize it. Amen? The only way to come out of these is to seek the face of the Lord, to go pray and seek Him. There must be a place of reality to an individual every single day. Every day that reality must come. Because the enemy tries to steal the reality that he exists. He tries to steal the reality of our seal of who we are. He tries to steal our garments in exchange for prison garments. I was a prisoner. Been in and out of jail, went to prison. They make you wear garments. But even those who are in prison now, they may have a garment on, a prison garment, but if they're born of the Spirit and seeking God's face, they have a priestly garment. Amen? 2 Corinthians 3. Now remember, didn't Jesus say, "Look at man, you got the wrong garments on"? There's so many doctrines out there saying you can get to heaven this way, you can get to heaven this way. Many people, "Oh, I don't even believe in heaven or hell." Well, I don't know one unbeliever that's not in hell now. Everyone that's there is a believer. Problem is, it's too late. Amen? They believe when they got there. And it wasn't an "oh snap." Second Corinthians 3, verse 1. Do we begin again to commend ourselves? Or do we need, as some others, epistles of condemnation to you, letters of commendation from you? You are what? Come on, read it with me. You are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Clearly you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is of the heart. And we have such trust through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit brings what? Life. We are a walking word of God. The word says that the word became flesh and dwelt among men. Well, now the flesh became word. That's why we're known as, we are become the epistle. Amen? Is everybody okay? Walking word of God, facing reality by the face of reality. Titus chapter 3. Titus 3. And verse 4. Titus 3, verse 4. Would you read it with me, please? But when the kindness of the love of God, our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying. And these things I want you to what? Affirm when? Constantly. Constantly. That those who have believed in God should be careful. Careful to do what? Maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men, but avoid foolish disputes, genealogies, contentions, and strivings about the law, for they are unprofitable and useless. Reject a divisive man after the first and second admonition, knowing that what? Such a person is warped and sinning and being self-condemned. In other words, be careful of association. Associations bring what? Impartations. There is a constant regeneration going on with me and you. If you're truly seeking, it stops when you stop. When you stop, it stops. But as you can constantly seek the Lord, you stay in fellowship, you abide, you read the word, you speak, you declare. Then there's a regeneration. Amen? So there must not only be a regeneration, but a renewing. Go to Romans 12. Romans chapter 12. A regeneration and a renewing must be a constant thing. That's what allows you and me to abide. And if we're abiding, we're producing fruits of righteousness. It's when we stop is when we begin to produce fruits of lawlessness. Because connection is broke. Yeah. Is everybody there? Amen. Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. Let's speak it. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Holy. Hello. Holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or your responsibility. And do not be conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That you may prove God's will. That means you're promoting it, you're agreeing with it, and you're manifesting it. Amen? Colossians 3. Before us, who can be against us, right? He says, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. He says, grab hold of me and I'll grab hold of you. But as soon as you let go, he lets go. He waits. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1. Everybody there? So we want to maintain. That's why we always keep the Lord before us. I will always constantly say this. Because if you're not keeping the Lord before you in everything, then you're easily misled. You'll make decisions not according to the will of God, but according to how you feel and according to man's will and not God's will. In verse 1, let's speak it. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are where? Above. Where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Hello. There's people still setting their mind more on the things of the earth than they do on God. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. Therefore, put to death your members and your desires, which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. And because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the what? Sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to what? Put off all these anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds and have put on the new man, who is renewed in the knowledge according to the image of him who created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised nor uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on what? Tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, you also must do so. But above all these things, put on what? Love, which is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or in deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Again, we are in such a time right now where wickedness is manifesting and doesn't even care. They don't even care if you know that they're there. They don't care. They are promoting such doctrines of demons and such demonic influence. We are hard-pressed constantly. You must be careful. Listen, the devil uses technology. Amen? That's why I call Facebook Fleshbook. There are people who are losing their righteous garments and putting wicked ones on just by using that technology. They are practicing lawlessness and no longer practicing righteousness. And you'll know them by their fruits. Believers who once believed are now become heathens, breaking covenant with God, not willing to follow, putting up the mask and become pretenders, hypocrites. We see it all over. But by the Spirit of God, and if we seek the face of God, he'll burn through every mask. He'll burn through everything and allow the true identity of who you are in Christ be expressed and maintaining that connection with him. Amen. Listen, this is the day the Lord has made. Today is the day of salvation. I want to encourage every single one today that if you're not right with God and you have backslidden in any way whatsoever, that you rededicate your life to Christ. This is important. How do you know what's going to happen when you leave here today? If you're not his, then you're someone else's. Amen? And if you're not following, you're not his. Today he says, call out on my name. Humble yourself. Seek me and turn from your ways. And I'll heal you. I'll heal you of your wounds. I'll remove your sins. And I'll place my spirit in you that will help you and empower you to follow me and do what's right. Today is the day. Don't leave this place without asking for his forgiveness, for his mercies, for his grace, and rededicating your life back to him today. Do it before you take communion. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Let this seed be imparted to each and every one. Be protected by the blood of Christ and let it grow and bear fruit for your glory, bringing the reality of time, season, where we are and who we are in you. Preparing our hearts for communion in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen.